السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. We ask Allah to bless them all, to bless every one of us, and to bless our offspring, those to come up to the end of time. May Allah keep them steadfast on the deen, and may Allah keep us all steadfast as well. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, it's important for us to look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the ideal role model. He is the only creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or human being, whom we can look at from every aspect of his life and say he's a role model. When it comes to the rest of us, we only take part of what the person may have succeeded in and consider them role models in that particular part alone. Let me give you an example. A person who excels at university, for example, they would be role models for those who want to excel at university, even though that person may not be a good Muslim. You hear my point? We don't take the part from them that they miss their salah, or they may not be Muslim at all. We have Steve Jobs. He's a role model for a lot of people. In what? That's the question. Just in one aspect of his life. We have, for example, some of your lecturers who might be brilliant people, really dedicated, selfless people. They are your role models. In what? In that particular aspect. You have, for example, a reciter of the Quran, powerful, reads beautiful. He's got everything it needs to be able to render an eloquent, beautiful, heart-wrenching recitation. He is a role model in what? In reciting the Quran, and so on and so forth. You have someone who's got a lot of knowledge of the deen. They are role models in what? In that particular aspect. I hope you get what I'm saying. Similarly, you have, say, an athlete, a trainer in the gym, whoever else it is, role models. We want to be like them in what? In a little aspect of their lives. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no aspect of his life is not, or no aspect of his life is not upon the highest level. It is all upon a level that is not only worth us following, but it is considered an act of worship for us to follow. So this evening, seeing that we're speaking here at this beautiful university, UCT, University of Cape Town, alhamdulillah, I would like to go through one aspect of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I want it to be a means of inspiration for us all, myself included. It is called waiting for the turning point in others. What does that mean? It's something amazing. Waiting for the turning point in others is part of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Okay, in his case, it was waiting for the turning point in others. In our case, because we are not prophets of Allah, it is a turning point within us as well. And for that, we should not be waiting. But for others, we are patient, we should continue, we should be dedicated, we should have hope, we should pray for them. That's the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What did he do when he saw Abu Jahl? Abu Jahl was the biggest enemy of Islam. He continued making dua for him. He continued trying with him. He was kind to him. Although Abu Jahl was cruel to him, he continued having hope. He continued in so many good things regarding Abu Jahl. And he always felt that definitely this man is going to come, if Allah wills, to the deen. So much so, the time when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, who was much younger than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 13 years younger than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was a strong man, feared, loud, intolerant. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make dua for him as well as Abu Jahl in the same sentence. He has said, Allahumma a'izzal Islam bi ahadil umarain. Before I translate that, let me tell you something. When you see a person who's powerful in authority, who's got a lot of clout, and they're not Muslim, or they're using their energy in a destructive way, and you keep on having hope that, you know, if this energy can be used in the right direction, it will definitely do a great service to Islam and the Muslimin. This person has potential. We're not looking at the evil that's coming from them. We're looking at the potential, the strength, the dedication with which they're using these energies in a wrong way. And we are saying, if it can be channeled in the correct way, subhanallah, it would be amazing, because this person
effortlessly goes and makes people's lives difficult. Imagine if they had to be effortlessly going to make people's lives easy, how brilliant it would be. That is heavenly. That is prophetic. It's amazing. He had hope. And he kept on saying, "Oh Allah," and this is the translation of that dua, "grant strength to Islam through the acceptance of Islam of one of the two Umars." One was known as Amr ibn Hisham, that was the proper name of Abu Jahl, and one was Umar ibn al-Khattab, the man we know, radiallahu anhu, later to be known as. So he kept making this dua, and he kept asking, and he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do you know why? He was waiting for the turning point in them, waiting for it. He knew it would come when Allah wills, if Allah wills. But for him, he knows his duty was to convey the message, to keep on being kind, be the best person, continue having hope, they will come one day. And they came. One of them came, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And the day he came, there was strength granted to Islam. The man used his energy. He used his reputation in society. He used the authority that he had to a certain extent in the right direction. Because he says, as soon as he accepted Islam, أَلَسْنَا عَلَى الْحَقِّ, are we not on the straight path? And the Prophet ﷺ says, yes, we are, indeed we are. Why should we fear people? Let's fulfill salah in public. Let's engage in our prayer in public. Why should we be worried about these people of Quraysh, who, that they may harm us, they may do this, they may do that. They can do nothing. I am there. Allah is there. So they had these two rows of people. One was led by Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib and the other was led by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. They marched in full view of the people of Quraysh to the Haram, to Mecca. For the first time they read Salah in congregation. At that time Salah was not yet compulsory, it was still a voluntary act of worship. And they went forth and they engaged in Salah. The Salah that was given in Mi'raj was that Salah which was now compulsory. And that's when it became five times a day. That is later on. But earlier it was voluntary. It was only two units and it was voluntary. So they got to the Kaaba, they got to the front and they read Salah. Openly, they read Salah clearly. They used to face Jerusalem at the time. It's something unique. But the point being raised is Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was really a man whom Allah used in order to strengthen the deen. And from this, it teaches us never lose hope in people. Never ever. No matter who they are, your children, your friends, the drunkard, the one in the clubs, the one on drugs, the one who has the worst qualities, keep on praying, keep on trying, keep on having hope. Keep on being kind and keep on explaining the truth, continuing to explain the truth in a beautiful manner. You don't need to become harsh. You don't need to become hard. Because Allah says in the Quran, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. It is because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you were lenient with them or upon them. You were kind to them. You were soft with them. Allah says that is the mercy of Allah. When you're soft with people, when you're kind to them, when you're lenient with them, it's a sign of the mercy of Allah upon you. And Allah says if you were hard-hearted, if you were harsh and hard-hearted, they would have dispersed from around you. They wouldn't have listened to you. You have people who don't want to hear a message of doom. They want to be told, you know, with a pat on the back, don't worry, you're doing well, but you can do better. It's a way of speaking. Don't worry, you're doing well. Each one of us has a struggle. We are all trying. I said it this morning at another university, and to be honest, I live by it. I know there are struggles, myself included. We are all struggling to earn the pleasure of Allah and to improve. No matter what level I am upon or you are upon, every one of us knows we are trying to become better people as the days pass. So much so that if I were to ask you today, how many of you read five salah a day? I'm sure I would see most of the hands, I hope. And if I were to ask you how many of us read Salatul Tahajjud, for example, I would see slightly less hands. But in your heart, you know, I want to get there someday. And by the mercy of Allah, He sometimes inflicts you with something that makes you get up for tahajjud. Do you know why? He just wants you to taste the sweetness of it. How many of us have had a difficulty that led us to this late night prayer, early morning prayer, in a way that we tasted its sweetness? Even after the problem was gone, we still get up once in a while and we love pleasing Allah in that way. The prayer that no one's watching, that's a gift of Allah. So we all have our struggles, the sisters perhaps, with all the peer pressure, perhaps the environmental pressure, in whatever way it is. You know, everything that's happening around us, the environment. Sometimes it's difficult even to dress appropriately. You know your struggles, and therefore you know that you'd like to improve this and you'd like to improve that. And perhaps I believe firmly that every one of us improves as time passes. And wherever we falter and drop, we turn back to Allah. Imagine someone coming to you and say, you know what, you're not worth it. You're still going to hell. That's it. Can you feel it burning? Allah forgive us. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, waited patiently. He kept on dedicatedly reminding the people to say, hang on, this is the path, this is Allah, this is the way. And he did not lose hope, and he continued the same message over and over again in different words. If you look at the reminder of Salah, how many times does it appear in the Quran? Anyone knows? Where Allah says, establish your Salah. We all know it's more than once, it's more than twice, it's quite a few times. The reason is Allah's telling you, hang on, there are so many different times and places in the Quran and wordings, because one of them may affect you. As you're reading the Quran, we are taught to read it from cover to cover. Say for example, and this is something unique, to also taught by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hearts of the people are not the same every day, and they fluctuate and change. So grab that heart when it's at a point where it is going to absorb what's coming in the direction of it in terms of spirituality, in order to give it a good message. So I give you an example. You're busy reading the Quran at the beginning of Ramadan, and mashallah, you're excited and so on, and you're reading the meaning of it, and Allah tells you to establish your salah, establish your prayer. And it didn't really hit you that much, because as it is, you're reading Taraweeh and you're going on and on and on. And then when it comes to the second half of Ramadan, you start softening up a bit, because you know, with us, the month of Ramadan, you climax at the end, right? At the beginning, everything is still okay. I've got 29 days, 28 days to go. Hey, there's only 6 days to go. Let's get serious. That's how Ramadan is. It's unique. It's, you know, it's like a long race, a marathon. Near the end, everyone becomes more serious to say, now we've got to win, alhamdulillah. Not to say we weren't running at the beginning. But to be honest, as time passes, you read it again. There may come a time of the day that will be different. There may come something that's happened in your day, that particular day, that has made you think from a different angle. Something that might have happened in your life that makes you feel, this is the time for me to change. This is the time for me to turn. And then you turn, and you only turned because that message was repeated in a different wording at a different time, but it was the same message. Subhanallah. If you ask yourself, you know, these imams who come to talk to us, these scholars who come to talk to us, perhaps the halaqat that we have that are a reminder for us. If you ask yourself, what is the message? To be honest, it's always the same message. Always. It's telling you to get closer to Allah, to become a better person, to improve yourself, to worry about what's to come after death and so on. All of the messages are the same, but the way they're worded, different. The timings, different. I believe that there are certain times of the day when people are more receptive to religious instruction, perhaps. I believe perhaps like at this time here, the evening, early evening, it's a very blessed time. Early morning, very blessed time. You know, the early hours of the morning, subhanallah, you and Allah. Imagine reading a book, listening to a talk, and suddenly it strikes a chord, as they say. You changed. The same way you can change, have hope in the rest of the people, the rest of them. Everybody can change. That is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He always had hope. Let me give you another example. A companion we spoke about this morning by the name of Khalid ibn al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, radiyallahu anhu. Powerful man. I'm sure we've heard his name, okay? After the battle of Uhud and after the treaty of Hudaybiyah, the Prophet ﷺ called his brother, who was already a Muslim and he was already in Medina, and said, where is Khalid? Imagine, the man is gone, he's in Mecca. The man is not even in Medina, the man just fought us, the man is part of the enemy. But the Prophet, peace be upon him, is calling his brother, says, where is Khalid? So the brother is answering to say, okay, you know, a simple answer. The Prophet ﷺ says, مَا مِثْلُ خَالِدٍ يَجْهَلُ الْإِسْلَامِ. He says, a man like Khalid, so intelligent, so bright, he's got such a mind, he is an expert, he's got a top brain, he cannot be ignorant of the correctness of Islam. That's all he said. The Prophet, peace be upon him, is saying, this man, no matter what he's done, he didn't harp on the fact that, you know, in Uhud there were 70 people martyred, and in, this is what happened in the other war, and Khalid did this, and nothing of that nature. He's a leader, he has hope, he's waiting for the turning point. That's a sunnah, that's part of the seerah, and it is consistent throughout the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Absolutely, all the time, right up to the end, he had hope. Including his uncle Abu Talib, who was a man who did not accept the faith. But the Prophet, peace be upon him, on the deathbed of this man Abu Talib, he goes to him and says, oh my uncle, utter one statement and I will fight your case on the day of judgment. What was that? Hope, waiting for a turning point, hoping for a turning point even at the last moment. That's a sunnah. So Khalid ibn al-Walid, the Prophet, peace be upon him, says he will not be ignorant of it because he has such a top brain. He will definitely be thinking about it. In the meantime, Allah alone knows what's happening to Khalid ibn al-Walid. He's considering. He says, no. These people are so dedicated. They're so kind. Yes, we fought them. Yes, I have the wrong perception of who they are. That's what's happening today on the globe as well. A lot of people don't know much about Islam. A lot of people look at it with skepticism because what do they hear? Exactly what Khalid ibn al-Walid ibn al-Mughira radiallahu anhu heard before Islam. He actually went out to fight the Muslims. And what happened? Because of the hope, because of the goodness, because of the kindness, because of the character and the conduct of the rest of the Muslimin and so on, he continued, meaning he started thinking about Islam. No way. This is a religion. It's a faith. But he had one problem. What was the problem? I've killed people. I've committed sin. I've committed so much. I've harmed. I've done. I don't think I'm going to be forgiven. It took him a bit of a while. He built the courage to come to Medina Munawwara. And when he came in, the Prophet, peace be upon him, knew what was happening. He knew, he had a feeling, this man is coming in, he's going to declare his faith. But Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu did not declare his faith immediately. He had a question. He had a question to ask. What was the question? Oh, Messenger, I've done so much. What's going to happen to that? I've committed sin. You know what I did in Uhud and so on. The details. He says, what's going to happen to that? And the Prophet ﷺ says, Ya Khalid, inna al-Islam yajubbu ma qabla. Oh Khalid, Islam, the fact that you are entering the fold will delete all the bad that you've done in the past. Guess what? The good is carried through. Subhanallah. The bad and the evil is deleted, wiped out, gone. Subhanallah. He says, he asked the question again. He got the same answer. He asked the question a third time. He got the same answer. Then he stretches his hand. He says, on that condition, I bear witness, you are indeed the messenger of Allah. None worthy of worship besides Allah, and you are the messenger of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was how Khalid ibn al-Walid entered the fold of Islam. Look at the beauty, look at the goodness. But did the Prophet, peace be upon him, say, no, that's an enemy. La'natullahi alayhi. Allah's curse on him. He's a write-off. It's over. We do that with Muslims. We do that with Muslims. This person is like this. That one is like that. This one is a goner. What are you talking about? It just depicts the condition of our own hearts. And this is why I say, be patient. Wait for the turning point in others. And as for yourself, ask yourself, am I going to live to see the next morning? Why should I wait to turn myself? So when it comes to others, we are lenient. When it comes to ourselves, we should not be lenient. Turn now. Be hard on yourself. Don't be hard on others. You ask yourself, why am I not fulfilling my daily prayers? Why am I not dressing appropriately? Why do I not worship Allah alone? Why do I have weaknesses of superstitious beliefs and so on? Why am I engaging in this? Ask yourself those hard-hitting questions. But when it comes to others, guide them slowly. They will come at their pace, if Allah wills. And if you take a look at the other companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the same applied. Let's take a step further from Khalid ibn al-Walid. What was the next step? They had the victory of Mecca. Abu Sufyan, who was the leader of the Meccans, he was one of the enemies of Islam, who was the leader of the armies, some of the armies that fought the Muslimin. and the victory of Mecca, when the Muslimin were marching onto Mecca with their power, their might, their numbers, they would have wiped out anything in their path. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, says, anyone who enters the house of Abu Sufyan is safe. Do not harm anyone who doesn't hold a weapon. Do not harm the women and the children and the elderly. Do not harm the one who doesn't want to fight you. Do not harm the one who's gone into the places of worship. Take a look at what the Muslimin are doing today in the name of Islam. Places of worship, astaghfirullah. They're harming people in the places of worship, not only non-Muslim, but Muslimin. This message was about non-Muslims. Non-Muslims in their places of worship, no matter who and what they are worshipping. The fact that they are in their places of worship, they are not supposed to be harmed. By the lip of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, whoever enters their place of worship is supposed to be safe. What are we doing? Take a look at how we've become so hard-hearted. We've turned away from the basic teachings of Islam. I'm not talking about us seated here perhaps, but I'm talking about some activity that is happening in the name of Islam. Not in my name, not in yours, not in the name of Islam. That is incorrect, it's wrong. So when people talk about following the example of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the problem we have is a lot of people think that it's only connected to one aspect or two aspects. What about all this? What about what I've said today? Did you know that when we talk of the seerah and the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every aspect of your life is connected to it? Every single aspect, whatever you've done, your salah, your walking, your talking, your cleanliness, what we could be speaking about the tahara and cleanliness and how to wash and how to bathe, and that would be the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his sunnah. It would be, because it's part and parcel of it. It's unique, it's amazing. But I believe that sometimes, because of our weakness, we pick and choose, and then we label others, and then we look at others and start believing that we are better Muslimin than them. And this is where we falter. Let's keep on trying, let's keep on having hope. But my brothers and sisters, there is always a turning point in our lives. Allah does not leave a single human being without direct reminders to him or her in his or her life. It's not possible. The minute you arrive at the age of puberty, it's your duty to find Allah. It's your duty to look for him. And he will reach out to you, because he says clearly, Man atani yamshi ataytuhu harwala. There is a beautiful hadith where he says, whoever comes to me a handspan, I come to him a foot. Whoever comes to me walking, I come to him rushing. It's impossible for you to look for your maker and he's not looking for you. You look for him a little bit, he'll reach out to you. But those signs need to be translated and interpreted in the correct sense. Sometimes it's in the form of a calamity. Sometimes it's in the form of prayers being answered. You know how it feels when you're here at the university and you've just written the most important examinations and you're praying. What happens? You become a good Muslim for a little while, don't you? MashaAllah. Yes, it is. Oh Allah, I promise you. I promise you, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. And then you know, you see your boyfriend after a while. Allah forgive us. It happens, doesn't it? Because why? I need to pass my exams. The minute you see your results, hey, and you're back again. Allahu Akbar. May Allah forgive us. This is reality striking. That was Allah reaching out to you. Allah says, you called out to me. Here, I gave it to you. What happened? You appreciate, you thank Allah. You know, like we say, you can have a guy in your life, but you just need to regularize it. That's all. See, those who've understood what it means. It's not an easy task. You can have a guy. You know, you can have the woman of your dreams, you need to regularize it. It reminds me of a guy who came to invite everyone with a little card to say, I'm getting married, I'm getting married. I'm getting married to who? Hey, to the king's daughter. Like, the princess. Oh, you getting married to the princess? And he used to just clean the streets. Yes, I am. How did you do it? He says, no, it's almost done, 50% confirmed. How 50%? Well, I'm extremely happy, I'm just waiting for them to accept. Allahu Akbar. May Allah help us. May Allah guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. But the point I'm raising is, Allah creates things in our life. Sometimes you fail after you were calling out to Allah, because Allah wants you to do better. Wallahi, sometimes failure makes you a person who is much better in character. Do you know that you have people sometimes who develop an arrogance because they pass just like this? They develop an arrogance. They become people who think, hey, you know, that's it, it's me. Thank you, fans. Thank you all, you know. To be honest with you, Allah will wake you up one day to say, you know what? You're just one human being. You're going to return to me. These degrees are all temporary. They will help you for a few years. What's going to help you for the entire life after death is your relationship with me. We're not saying don't become whatever you want to become. Become, but understand that will only help you when you serve Allah through your field, over and above serving Allah through what He has made obligatory upon you. So how I start as a Muslim, if I want to follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I will start off with my obligations. I'll be a good Muslim. I'll try my best to fulfill my salah, to dress appropriately. My social relations need to be pure and clean and so on. I need to treat people with respect and what have you. Over and above that, if I am, for example, a doctor, I will ensure that I am honest, trustworthy, hardworking. I serve dedicatedly, Muslim, non-Muslim, whoever it is. Even if you're a veterinary, you could enter paradise through that. Do you want to hear the evidence? People say, what? You mean I just look after dogs and I can enter heaven? The answer is perhaps, yes, it could be. If your intentions are right and you're doing it with the right reasons, compassion, being compassionate towards these animals, it's something great and grand. Listen, I'm not encouraging it. I'm actually just saying it's permissible. That's all. I don't want people to give up medicine and say, right, we're becoming vets now. Because if you take a look at the hadith, it's the third time I'm mentioning it in this season of my presence in Cape Town, of the woman who entered Jannah because she quenched the thirst of a dog. What happened? She wasn't even a vet. A vet has spent a lot of time, and when they go, you know, to an ailing dog that is perhaps dying, and they, for example, administer some medication or whatever it be to that particular dog, and the dog is doing well and it can bark properly, you know, rah, rah, you know, what would happen? Subhanallah. You weren't expecting that, were you? Mashallah. You know, I was just telling the uncle here that, you know, when we got a talk for youth and the university students, I enjoy it because I can just be myself. The minute you see old people with white gray hairs here, you know, I couldn't do what I just did I? But the point is, you get happy because the dog is once again on his feet, walking around, wagging its tail, whatever, and it's gone. So if Jannah and paradise was achieved by the quenching of the thirst of the dog, what if something more dedicated is provided for that dog? Don't you think there's a greater chance of getting Jannah? Common sense. Subhanallah. We ask Allah to open our doors. So let's be hopeful. Let's try. Let's use our field to reach out to people. Let's become better. And let's remember that sometimes, because of our haughtiness and arrogance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that it's best for us not to get exactly what we want. And it brings me to one very interesting point. None of us, not a single one of us, will have everything we want on earth every time. No, not one. Because we were not sent to the earth in order to have whatever we want. There's a special place known as paradise where that will come. If we had whatever we wanted on earth, what was the point of going to a place called heaven? Where Allah says, you get whatever you want. You say, well, I've already got whatever I want. There was no point. So Allah says, you coming here, we will just test you. Because if you watch carefully, some of you will pass away early. Some pass away a little bit later. Some live a long, long life and then they pass away. Everyone passes away. Where are they going? Why is it that they were here so short? They're going somewhere. I was talking a few days ago to someone, a non-Muslim, and they were speaking about death and how it is. And I said, you know what? I believe that when we die and we see what we get later on, we're going to tell ourselves, hey, I wasted too many years back there. It was such a dump. Back there meaning back way. Here. Sorry for calling this place a dump. But to be honest, you wouldn't know. You have to have belief. You're going to a better place. You're a mu'min. You've believed in Allah. If He could give this to me, then definitely He's got something far better in store for me. If He's told me that, I believe it. Really. And so when I go there, I will be so delighted. Stop fearing so much that you get depressed. Hey, I'm getting old. I might die. You're not, you might die. You will die. And we're not saying that in a dooming way. We're saying it in a reality hitting way, subhanAllah, to say, look, just prepare. Just praise Allah. Wherever you faltered, ask Allah's forgiveness. Get back on the track and walk again in the right direction. Allah didn't say you won't falter. He knows your nature. He knows you personally. He knows your struggles. He hears you. He has a link with you. Remember this. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He made people feel the love of Allah. He made people feel the connection with Allah. Because he was connected with them, and he made the people feel that he was one of them, although he was far superior in the sense that he was the messenger of Allah, the most noble of all prophets, the highest of all creation. But not once did he say, you know what, I'm better than all you guys here. No, the hadith says the Prophet ﷺ, when he sat with people, he sat like he was one of them. Amazing. He sat like he was one of them. He treated everyone with utmost respect. How many of us can do that to the others? I tell you one difficulty that we have in this ummah at the moment. We don't greet each other. No greeting whatsoever. No salam. Unless you know the person or you want something from them, or perhaps they're wealthy or authority or popular or whatever else. Otherwise, there's no greeting. No. We have these faces that are all screwed up, literally. You know, astaghfirullah. And what happens? You look at the other person, you look away and you're gone. But you're a Muslim, you're a Muslim. Learn to greet. I tell you, I've seen non-Muslims do better than us. Wallahi, I'm not joking. Good morning, sir. They will tell you as they pass you. Morning, ma'am. Good afternoon. They'll tell you, hi, how are you doing? Fine. You hear all these words, subhanAllah, coming from whom? Non-Muslims. They greet you. But you're a Muslim, you can't greet a fellow Muslim. You can't even greet others, no one. I'm just there, I'm my own person, dry, cold, that's it. It's me. Do you know that by greeting someone, you're actually engaging in a huge act of worship? You're achieving closeness to your maker because you share the same creator. Why do we call ourselves brothers and sisters? Because firstly, it's in humanity. We have the same creator. We have the same forefathers. And thereafter, if you still share the same faith, you've got even more in common. What we do today, we concentrate on the differences, that's all. I've got 50 million issues in common. 5 differences, you're my enemy. That's it. That's it. This is not the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He seized the opportunity to look into all his companions. He used them for what they were keen in. Some of them could read and write. He used to call them and tell them, write down this revelation on some occasions. Some of them were experts, for example, in learning. He told them, come here, I want you to learn this language and that language. I want you to do this and that. They learned, they memorized. Some of them were experts, for example, in sewing or in carpentry. He told them, come, we'd like a mimbar. And they made a mimbar. You know, mimbar, the pulpit of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was made by a carpenter, the experts. They were all experts. Some of them were business people, top businessmen. And he acknowledged it. And then he went out and said, "At-tajiru as-saduqul aminu ma'an nabiyyina was-siddiqina was-shuhada was-salihin." You know, a businessman who is honest and trustworthy will be resurrected with the messengers and the pious and the martyrs on the day of judgment. Wow. And what were you doing? Business. That's it. I was a businessman, but I was honest. So from this we learn, whatever your field is, no problem. Study it, develop in it. You know, the sky is not even the limit. It's beyond the skies. But be a good Muslim. There must be a turning point in your life. You have to turn. You have to come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's goodness, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors. أَقُولُ مَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ وَبَارَكَ عَلَى نَبِيْنَا مُحَمَّدْ وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانًا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Brothers and sisters, we are fortunate here to have a delegation from Malaysia. Some of you might have heard about it. We have Ms. Nina who's with us this evening. She's actually known as Sister Shazrina. And mashallah, she's here seated with us. She had a life that I think she can explain to us. Would you mind coming and talking to us for a few minutes? Can I say a few words? You don't mind? Okay, bismillah. So she was a singer, perhaps up the pop charts in Malaysia, well known, complete, in the sense that she did very, very well in her own field of singing and being one of the pop queens, if I'm not mistaken, okay? And there came a turning point in her life. Like I spoke about this evening, you know, this turning point, somehow whatever it was, Allah knows best, she knows perhaps. There was a turning point. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided her to quit the fast lane in terms of the world and to enter the real fast lane in terms of gaining closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So alhamdulillah, we thank Allah. I believe she's an inspiration for so many, not only in Malaysia but across the globe. So many who follow, so many who've seen. And she has this journey that she's making to parts of the world to visit some of the scholars, to see some of the people and to learn. So inshallah, she has a few questions that she wanted to ask. We haven't managed to get all the questions down. I want to open the floor for questions inshallah, but would you agree we let her ask her questions first inshallah? There we are, inshallah. Barakallahu fik. So if you can go ahead inshallah, we will take a few questions from you inshallah. Okay.
My first question is, we do focus always on our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but sometimes we forget about our relationship with people like our parents, our neighbors and friends, and even sometimes our enemies. I know you kind of spoke about it a little bit before. What would be your advice for people who actually have this kind of problem or imbalance?
Okay, let's take the first question. She says, if you haven't heard the question, that we focus on our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we always speak about it. What about the relationship with the others, with the creatures of Allah? For your information, that's a beautiful question, because in Islam, if you open the books of jurisprudence, you will find your link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala connected to salah and zakah and, for example, sawm and so on. It covers a quarter of the book. Three quarters of the book is connected to your relationship with the rest of humankind. I'll give you an example. Nikah is marriage. When you marry, you related to someone. From that, you have new relatives. You have new acts of worship that you need to engage in that you would not be able to engage in had you not been married. And that is getting along with your in-laws. It's a big act of worship. You need to get along with your in-laws. It's a tough one. You need to actually make things work. It is sacrifice, it is patience. We're so excited and happy because mashallah, you know, we make a beautiful couple when we walk together, but the minute we enter the home, hey, there's a disaster here, because you got this one, you know, on your neck or on your head, on your throat all the time, and you got the other one there bombarding you. But the truth is, you need to be calm, you need to be collected. Take a look at what we said earlier. You need to keep on hoping for a turning point, inshallah, a positive one. You need to fulfill rights. If someone is bad, do not become bad so that the two of you are both equal. You keep on being good. Don't lose your bad habits because of the bad habits of others. Don't lose your bad character because of the bad character of others. So in Islam, if you take a look at these books, then you have talaq, which is divorce. Divorce opens the door of acts of worship that are so difficult. If you were to fulfill them, you would earn Jannah. Can I give you one example? A person who's gone through divorce after they've had children will always be connected to the father of those kids or the mother. No matter what, say what you want. You want to get him out of your face, it's not going to happen through divorce. It's really not. You will have to, because you share children. Those children have a God-given right of visitation or custody with one of the two, and the other one must cooperate. The only time that doesn't apply is when there is an evil person with so bad qualities, like someone who's molested their children, someone who is evil, who's perhaps a drunkard, where we fear the safety really of our children, not just fearing the safety because you just don't want to give them the kids and so on. This is an act of worship. It requires patience, dedication, not to speak bad about the parent of the child just because you didn't get along with them. It is the parent of the child. Yes, you may want to warn them about bad habits and qualities. They may ask you what went wrong. Sometimes you don't need to tell the children all the details, the nitty-gritties, because they may begin to hate one of the two. And who knows, it might just be you, because you're going to speak bad, the other one's going to speak bad, and the children are confused and they end up perhaps disgruntled, suicidal, and you don't even know. So divorce opens up a huge door of worship. Have you ever thought of that? But people don't think that. They think, you know what, it's going to be the end, finished, we're cutting the cord. No way, you can never cut a cord. Yes, if you don't have children, you can, perhaps. Then too, there is an act of worship, what you utter with your tongue. The Quran warns us about the sacredness of having been intimate with someone You don't go and describe the intimate relations to the rest of the world. The Quran tells us that. And this would mean more so when you've divorced, you don't go and start telling the world, you know, he is like this, he had this problem, that problem. So what? You don't need to justify anything. I've been through a divorce myself some moons back when I was a kid, mashallah. I was married for a few years, 2 years, 2.5 years. It ended up, and when people ask me, I say, she was a wonderful person, I was a wonderful person, I hope, and we just didn't get along. Alhamdulillah, we didn't get along. Two beautiful people, grown up perhaps slightly differently, they couldn't perhaps, you know, get along. That's it. And we ended up divorced. That's it. You don't need to start. What we've learned from Rasulullah SAW is, when you start bad-mouthing others, it causes within you a moment of sadness and depression. It brings about a lot of, let's say, lack of contentment. It snatches away your happiness. You will never get happiness by bad-mouthing others. It hasn't happened. It's a very temporary feeling that's fake of having won. When there was no war there, the test was for you. How did you speak? What did you say? So you have two things in Islam, huququllah and huququl ibad, the rights of Allah and the rights of fellow worshippers, the worshippers of Allah. So as we fulfill the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through salah and zakah, that's not the only deen. People say this person's a good Muslim because they're standing in salah, and you know what? They're fulfilling it so dedicatedly, and they dressed appropriately, and they give out charity, and they go for Hajj and Umrah. I hope not every year, because you'd have to lie if you want to go every year for Hajj. You know, one uncle tells me, I go every year for Hajj. I say, well, that means you're a liar. What do you mean? Because Sahuk asks you, have you been last year? If you say yes, you're not allowed to go. So you must have said no. May Allah forgive us. You see, we catch people, mashallah. It's not always meritorious to do that. But the point I'm raising is, sometimes people gauge a person based on their acts of worship or their link with Allah in terms of huququllah, the rights of Allah. But that person is failing when it comes to huququl ibad. Do you know what? We are taught that if you really want to know if your acts of worship are accepted, they begin to show in your character with the rest of the creatures. So if you want to know a noble person, take a look at how they treat others. That's all. You'll find out this person is really a good person. They are really close to Allah. For them, it is sacred. It's something they know. This is the creature of Allah. Let me treat it with respect. Subhanallah. So if you look at the hadith, there is a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, on the day of Qiyamah, there will come a person who is bankrupt. In fact, he asked a question, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ الْمُفْلِسِ? Do you know who is a bankrupt person? So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum said, well, according to us, he's a person who doesn't have dirham and dinar. That's a bankrupt person who doesn't have gold and silver. In our terms, perhaps dollars and pounds. We can't say the rand anymore because, you know. And thereafter, but it's a fact. So someone who doesn't have all that, that's who's bankrupt. So Rasulullah ﷺ says, no, it is a person who comes on the day of judgment with a lot of salah, with a lot of zakah, with a lot of acts of worship. You know, if I heard that, I would think I'm hearing wrong. A bankrupt person is one who comes on the day of Qiyamah, the day of judgment, with a lot of prayer, a lot of worship, a lot of acts of charity, a lot. How can that person be bankrupt? So he continues, he says, and then when they're standing in front of Allah with all these deeds of theirs, they have backbitten this one, gossiped about that one, they have slandered this one, eaten the wealth of the other, deceived another, and they have harmed another, and so on. So Allah takes away one by one these good deeds as a payment. Because on that day, the currency will be deeds. I need to pay back. So the deeds are going. So the salah in the first saf, gone. The zakah, gone. The hajj, gone. The fasting, gone. All the good deeds, gone. What happened thereafter? There are still so many people waiting for their rights. The Prophet, peace be upon him, says there will come a time when that man has nothing remaining and the people in front still want their right. And Allah says, okay, take your sins and put it on his shoulder. So the sins come, they are taken out and they put on the shoulder of this individual. But he was the one who used to read salah in the first saf. He was the charitable one. He was the holy, pious one according to the whole world. But because he usurped the rights of fellow human beings and he disregarded them completely, here he is paying. When he came with a lot. And as he is progressing on that day, in fact, there's no progress being made. He's going back because he's lost everything. And on top of that, he's got sins committed by other people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So this is a clean hadith that explains the importance of fulfilling the rights of fellow human beings. Absolutely, we need to make sure we are humble. And remember, it doesn't mean that you fulfill the rights of those who are pious alone. No, it doesn't mean you fulfill the rights of the Muslims alone, whether they are sinful, whether they are non-Muslims, no matter who they are and what they've done, they have rights. So much so, it doesn't stop at human beings. It stops at, it continues to all the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including the ecosystem, subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. I hope that explanation would help in understanding the importance of the rights of fellow human beings and how that is actually the fruit that is seen upon a person who is really and truly close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Barakallahu feek. The next question you had?
Next question is, I know that we know that our Prophet ﷺ has many, many attributes that made him loved, and people were very easily drawn to him. Can you share some examples on these characteristics that we can actually learn from?
Subhanallah. The Prophet, peace be upon him, had so many characteristics that endeared him to the people. They loved him. They really adored him. So what are some of these characteristics? Number one, he never lied. He always told the truth. When he spoke, he chose his words. They were actually chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he took his time. He spoke very clearly. Never did anyone have to say, huh? Honestly, sometimes when we speak in such a low tone, you know, we speak. That shows a complex mind sometimes, not all the time. Sometimes you're just lazy. But sometimes it's a complex mind. I recall learning the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam of a handshake. It's a nice, solid handshake. You know, you just below your thumb, this part here meets the same part of the other person, and it actually plugs in, and you grip it, and you shake it, and you look at the face, and you break into a little smile, and you say, assalamu alaikum. That's the proper sunnah. And then you have people giving you the two fingers. Have you seen that? It's like they don't want to shake your hand at all. Where are they going to be loved by anyone? You know, they just do this and next thing it's out. Shake it properly. Don't worry, the fungus on their hands is not going to come to you. It's a fact. This is something he says, greet the people. That's what he said. He greeted with a smile. He was a person who used to smile often at the people. And it is reported that he was absolutely free from hypocrisy. So much so that when he was sad, you could see it in his face. It wasn't hidden. He was sad. You could see, I've just upset him, because it was on his face. With us, we so hurt him. Salaam alaikum. And you know, you're there and you want to bash the person, but you haven't managed to say anything. Let them know, you know, sister, I'm hurt. What you said, what you did is bad. I'd rather sort out the mess than to let it grow as a hypocrite. Wallahi, we let the things grow like hypocrites. And the women are not the only ones. It's seeped into the men, honestly. We smile at each other and we hug each other and there's a dagger. You know, we're gone. I can imagine it. It happens. And these are plastic smiles that cause hatred in the ummah. Don't let it be. I'd rather confront a person who's a brother of mine. Brother, I love you. I care for you. You are a human being. You're a Muslim. You are my brother in faith. I really have a lot of respect for you. But I would just like to clarify this one point. It's a point that hurt me. Perhaps you have a clarification. They may not like it, but they will appreciate it long term. That was the messenger. He didn't mind. He told people. Similarly, when he was happy, you saw it on his face. The hadith says, "Kana idha surra istanara wajhuhu ka'annahu qita'atu qamar," sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Amazing. When he was happy, his face lit up as though it was a piece of the moon. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was so happy. You could see it. And then he had another quality. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum say, "La yahsabu jalisuhu anna ahadan akrama alayhi min." This is difficult for us to do. Do you know what it means? It means those who were seated around him at any time and his companions, none of them felt that there was anyone else more loved than they were to him. They all felt the same. So he gave them importance. He loved them. He made them feel so loved that each one of them thought, I'm the one he loves the most. That's what it is. Subhanallah. This was a gift. But can't we try? Subhanallah. You don't have to actually get to that level. You won't be able to. But at least be genuine with people. Learn to love. Learn to appreciate the good in others. We will be different. We have to. Learn to sacrifice. When the Prophet ﷺ instructed his companions to do something, he participated with them to fulfill it. Give you an example of the Battle of the Trench. The instruction came to dig a trench around Medina. He wasn't like the top shots of today, sitting in the background, letting everyone do the dirty work. No, he got in with them. He started digging with them. And some of them were showing that they had literally, at that time when they didn't have food, they would tie their bellies with a rock in order for the belly to become, you know, compressed slightly or pressed a little bit. So they showed each other their bellies. Hey, look, I got a rock tied here and I'm still digging. And guess what? When they saw the Prophet ﷺ, he had two rocks tied. Subhanallah, subhanallah, amazing. He was a man and he didn't mind. He worked with them, he participated. So if you want to be endeared to the people, learn to understand them, learn to participate with them. Do you know what he speaks, what he says regarding those who worked, those who were servants? He says, "Ikhwanukum khawalukum." These servants of yours are your brothers. Don't forget, they are your brothers. And ikhwan here refers to brothers and sisters, because in the Arabic language it's called taghlib. Taghlib meaning you use one gender referring to both. So these servants are your brothers and sisters. جعلهم الله تحت أيديكم. Allah has placed them under your authority. فمن كان أخوه تحت يديه. So whomsoever from amongst you, if your brother is under your authority, فليطعمه مما يأكل. He should feed them with the same food that he eats. وَلْيُلْبِسْهُ مِمَّا يَلْبَسْ. And he should clothe them with similar clothing to his. وَلَا تُكَلِّفُوهُمْ مَا يُغْلِبُهُمْ. And he should never ever, or he says, you should never ever burden them with something that is too difficult for them to fulfill. فَإِنْ كَلَّفْتُمُوهُمْ فَأَعِينُوهُمْ. If you really have to give them a task that is very hard for a person to fulfill, you get up and help them do it. Now that type of instruction, he was so loved even by the people who were serving him. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu was a young boy when his mother came with him and gave him to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a servant. He says, Wallahi, khadimtu Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam 10 sinin. I served the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 10 years. I was his servant. How many years? 10 years. Think about people at home, helping hands, those who assist you at home. 10 whole years. He says, فَمَا قَالَ لِيَ أُفٍ قَطُّ. Not once did he make a bad expression or a sound. Never. Negative. You know, We call it the TSE sound back at home, which means, you heard that sound? You know, they say, I'm sure this part of the world knows what I'm talking about. But that's what it is. He never did that. There in the Arab Peninsula, they call it uff. You say uff. That means it's as bad as that. وَمَا قَالَ لِي شَيْءٍ صَنَعْتُهُ لِمَ صَنَعْتَ. Not once in 10 years did he say, for something I did, why did you do this? He would correct it himself and carry on. With us, forget your servants, your spouse cooks for you, mashallah, brings the food for you. Every day it's a story. Allahu Akbar. May Allah forgive us. So this was the Prophet ﷺ. He was considerate, compassionate. He loved the people. He had so much of care for them. These were some of the qualities that we lack today. And yes, one might argue these are prophetic, but no, the level upon which they are may be prophetic, but the teaching is for us all. It's quite simple. So I hope that we too, you know, become people who are considerate of others. We have hope in others and we are hard on ourselves. It's a sacrifice. To be a person who's loved, you need to be a person who sacrifices. You need to be a person who tries. You need to be a person who's upright, earning the closeness of Allah. I can give you one hadith that brings tears to the eyes. Listen to it. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Inna Allah idha ahabba 'abdan nada Jibril. Fa yaqulu ya Jibril, inna Allah yuhibbu fulanan fa ahibba." When Allah loves a person, Allah calls Jibreel. And Allah says, oh Jibreel, Allah loves so and so, so you too love him. So Jibreel begins to love that person, and he calls out to the rest of the angels, "Oh angels, Allah loves such and such a person on earth. You all love them too." So they begin to love them, and they descend upon the earth with the love of that particular person. Wow, subhanallah. And this is why we say, "Ya Allah," you know, we say, "May Allah love us. Oh Allah, love me, I love you." Subhanallah. We say, "I love Allah, I love Allah," but we ask Allah, "Oh Allah, you love me too." Because if Allah loves you, there's nothing more you need. And the love of Allah does not mean you're going to have everything thrown at your feet. No. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most beloved to Allah. What did he have? He went through more difficult times than any one of us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us with a few of these qualities. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never raised his voice in a derogatory manner, you know, shouting, screaming. He was never vulgar. He was never ever saying hurtful things. With us, we are vulgar and hurtful every single day, and then we're wondering, why is it that no one likes us, no one loves us, and so on. You want to earn this? Go and study the seerah. Go and study the sunnah. Take a look at the qualities. When we say the way he spoke, the words he used, wallahi, just to think for a moment, this is what the Prophet, peace be upon him, taught. This is what he lived by. He was upon the highest level of contentment ever. Where are we? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us contentment, and may Allah open our doors. Jazakumullah khair. Any other questions? The sisters, I can take one question from somewhere. Can anyone raise their hands high if you want to ask a question? Yes, the sister here.
For the first time, and he warns him of that person. So, for example, that person has a habit of talking badly about others. So my friend, for example, would meet him, and I would warn him and say, "No, this person, you must be careful what you say to him, because he says he talks bad about people."
Okay, the question about gossip and how to deal with it and so on, and is there example at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? One thing comes to my mind. There may be more examples, but the one that comes to my mind is a slander, more of a slander than gossiping. But it was part and parcel of, you know, people messing their mouths by spreading this tale. It was slander and gossip at the same time. But the difference I'd like to think is, when it comes to a slander, it's definitely something wrong, totally unacceptable, in the sense that it's false. It's like an accusation that's now being spread. It's a slander. And this is why they say backbiting is to speak the truth about someone in a way that if they were there, they would have felt bad. That is called backbiting. Backbiting is not it's not connected to lies. It's connected to the truth. It's like sometimes you say, "But sister, you're backbiting." They say, "But I'm telling the truth." Well, that exactly is backbiting. That's what backbiting is. Subhanallah. So what is it if I'm lying? It's called slander, bohtan. I'm lying. So Aisha radiallahu anha, the wife of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was accused of adultery, of having an affair with Safwan ibn al-Mu'attal radiallahu anha. She was accused by who? The hypocrites. The man known as Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam initially, he kept quiet, because obviously for him to clear the wife's name, people would say, "Oh, that's just because it's his wife." And he let time pass by the instruction of Allah. In his case, it was because the categories of people and the lesson to come later on had to be made clear, that when slander comes, people fall into certain categories. The first category, those who don't want to hear, they don't want to talk about it, they throw it straight out of the window. That's the first category of people. They're not bothered. It doesn't bother you, throw it out. Second category of people, those whom they heard it in a closed circle, like Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, his wife told him, "Did you hear what happened regarding Aisha?" So he says, "Would you ever do that?" She says, "Never." "Well, if you wouldn't do it, she definitely didn't do it. So keep quiet, don't talk about it. It's actually a lie." So they threw it away after comparing themselves to it. That's the second category of people. And the third were those who spread it, those who spread the tale. And the fourth category, the one who created the tale. So Allah says at the end of that, every category will achieve a portion of their punishment. May Allah forgive us. The Prophet ﷺ later on cleared it. He clarified it. He read the verses. He went to the people. He told them. He spoke to them. He said whatever he wanted to. In fact, he went to Abdullah ibn Ubay, who was such a dirty man. He was the head of the hypocrites. And the reason why we can say that is because Allah informed Muhammad through revelation, and it was well known among the companions, and he died in that condition, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. He was known as Ra'sul Munafiqeen, the head of the hypocrites. All the companions knew this is a troublemaker. I'll give you one example. One day the Prophet went to him to clarify something. So he was so arrogant. He says, "Move away, move away. The smell of your donkey has harmed me." You know, the Prophet ﷺ was riding a donkey. He says, "The smell of this donkey has harmed me." So the companions, do you think they would remain silent? You know, you've got powerful people down there. They're not going to be quiet. So one of the companions says, "Your smell is worse than the sweet scent of this donkey." And then a battle ensued, which means some of the people who supported him wanted to attack this guy, and some of these people wanted to attack. But the moral of it is, this man was so, you know, dirty in the way he spoke. The Prophet ﷺ calmed everyone down. He sorted the matter. He said, "Look, let's get back to the purpose that we are here for, and let's try and sort it out. Let's not be distracted by this." Sometimes we get distracted. So this whole story that I'm mentioning goes to show that the Prophet ﷺ did clarify himself certain matters. And it is definitely a duty of our friends to clear our name on our behalf in our absence. And that is a great act of worship. I'll give you an example. Someone says something bad about you, and a friend of yours happens to hear it. For them to just nod their heads, say something, you know, which hasn't clarified anything, sometimes it makes it worse. That's not a good friend. They are supposed to, by right, say, "Listen, this is wrong. It's false. It's unacceptable. It's not true. Don't say it. Don't utter it." Like sometimes we are taught as Muslimin, Allah says it in the Quran, when you hear people engage in that which displeases Allah, get up and walk away. I've had brothers and sisters tell me that it's so difficult to get up and walk away. You know, everyone's having a chat. When you get together on a Saturday afternoon for tea, what are you talking about? All the other sisters who are not at the tea, right? In such a way that the day you're not at the tea, you can imagine what they're talking about, can't you? So the difficulty is for you, in order to stop that, you need to get up and tell the sisters, "Listen, it's an instruction of my Maker. I love you guys, all of you. But the speech that's there right now, I can't take it because it's against what Allah says. You're hurting someone, you're talking bad about them behind their back. I'm sorry, I've got to go." And you go. You do it once or twice, your gatherings will be free of speaking about others. My mother, in my own home, and I'm giving you this example, my father tells my mother, "When you go and visit your friends, do not sit for longer than 15 minutes. So my mother says, "And why?" She says, "Because the 16th minute, he says, the 16th minute, you start talking about Maryam and Fatima and Safiya and everybody else. But for 15 minutes, how are you? Everything okay? What's happening? How's things going? How's the children? Oh, mashallah, your child's at school. Oh, alhamdulillah, how are you coping? How was the cooking? What did you make today? Do you have a little bit of it left? Let's taste it," and so on. Mashallah, that's good. Everything happens. The 16th minute, you've got nothing more to say. So what do? You say, "You know, that sister there, watch out, be careful. You know, she's dangerous, she's poisonous. You know, she did this, this." That's backbiting. Forget about it, cut it. However, there is one exception. The Quran says, لا يحب الله الجهر بالسوء من القول إلا من ظلم. Allah does not like a person to make manifest evil about someone unless they themselves have been oppressed and they're seeking justice. I've had people who have been abused and they are reaching out for guidance, and they say, "I can't tell you what's happened because it's backbiting." You've been abused. Sometimes you've been oppressed. Your wealth has been usurped. You need to report. You need to seek help. You need to tell people, "This is what happened." So that is not considered backbiting. When it happened to you directly, someone oppressed me, I can warn the brothers to say, "Listen, my experience with this guy was X, Y, and Z. I have two intentions. One is to seek justice, and the other is to warn the brothers and sisters to say, 'Listen, be warned, I've already been bitten. Don't be bitten again.'" So that is the exception. You are allowed to do that. It's not considered backbiting, but the intention needs to be one of the two. Either I'm seeking justice, or I am respectfully warning others they shouldn't be bitten from the same hole. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness and understanding. definitely this Islam is actually quite complete. It is fully complete. We sometimes don't know much, so we keep on learning. Don't think for a moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not instructed us to clarify our name, you know, to clarify the names of our friends. It's wrong for us to sit back and relax when we know that a friend of ours is being spoken about in a dirty and a bad way. We're sitting there, we haven't said anything. It's your duty. Get up and say something. Wallahu a'lam. I hope that helped. The brothers, one question, inshallah. Yes?
Eid al-Adha and Eid al-Fitr with Mecca. Now, the question is, in Saudi Arabia, the king decrees when the new month starts. Is that not in direct conflict with the principles of Islam?
MashaAllah, my brother, if you ask people regarding the Eid al-Adha, they will deny that the king decrees it. They will deny that. And we will continue saying, no, he does. So because we have a conflict, I have one policy. Have your Eid today, have it tomorrow, have it the third day, or don't have it, but don't fight. That's my policy. Because for me, you'll never ever be able to bring the globe on one day. And we need to be mature about it. You have Eid, some want to follow this country, the other country, some don't want to do it, some want to, let them have it their way. Brother, Eid Mubarak to you. You do it today, Eid Mubarak. You do it tomorrow, Eid Mubarak. I'm happy I've got two Eids. You do it the third day, I'm happy I've got a third day. Alhamdulillah. I'm excited. You're South African, mashallah. The sale at my shop will extend 3 days, inshallah. So we look at it from a positive way. I am fed up of the fact that people are fighting over these things. To be honest with you, it's a blessed day. Shaitan comes to us and makes us fight. Sisters, brothers, whatever convinces you, do it that way. But this, remember, something else might have convinced someone else. Let them do it their way. It doesn't mean if it's not my way. This guy, he's following Saudi. He's not a proper Muslim. This guy is following this. He's not a proper. Relax. Those energies can be used in a more beautiful way. Come out and say, brother, Eid Mubarak. I'll be having Eid tomorrow, but have a blessed day. And here's some sweet dishes. Don't forget to give me mine tomorrow, inshallah. Make something good out of it. Why do we need to get excited? Another thing is, we all point fingers. We don't know reality sometimes. And sometimes our leaders are also quite guilty sometimes of, you know, should I say, adding fuel to the fire, so to speak. I'm sitting here. I know I'm in a position of leadership. But think about what I just said. I've tried to pacify in the sense that I've tried to say, listen, guys, let them have their way. You have your way. We don't need to fight. Yes, follow what you firmly believe is right. Let the others follow what they firmly believe is right. Alhamdulillah. How exactly they do it, they're answerable to Allah. I know once I asked a question that how come they always see the moon first? And I found a proper answer, because they use telescopes and everyone else doesn't. That's the reason. And according to Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, you are allowed to use telescopic vision. So they will always see the moon before anyone else. That's what it is. Because they're busy seeing it. Even if it's really, if you can't see it with the naked eye, they can see it. And they're not lying about it. They can see it. But it's what they're seeing it with. That's what I've understood it as. You get my point? But I still don't want to fight. I don't even want to argue about that point because it's irrelevant. And who knows, someone might say, no, you're wrong. So no problem. I'm not bothered. I just follow the moon of my area and I'm happy with it. Subhanallah. When Cape Town makes Eid, I make Eid with Cape Town. The man cakers are doing such a great job. MashaAllah. MashaAllah. Alhamdulillah. Allah bless you. I love you, my brother. Wallahi, and everyone here, you can have Eid today, tomorrow, or you might sleep through all the both of the Eids. I still love you. You're still my brother, man. Come on. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. I need to hug this man. Alhamdulillah. Jazakumullah khair, my brothers and sisters. I've enjoyed myself. I've let you in on a few of my own qualities. I hate it when you know, it is there. We do have differences. We will never be able to be on one opinion. Never. Learn to accept. Learn to adopt. Look, there's a difference of opinion. And learn to respect another opinion. Learn to respect it. Some people might not want to participate with you in certain things you do. Some people might want to do things you don't participate in. No problem, let them have it their way. Alhamdulillah, you want to discuss it from the perspective of knowledge. You want to discuss it properly. You want to look into its depth. You may do so, no harm. But we don't want to let that divide us further. We are such a divided ummah that at this moment, this juncture, this particular time in our history, we really need voices that bring us together. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all. Jazakumullah khair. Love you all for the sake of Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
You're Muslim.